so enthusiastic. I can hardly talk right now, but if you'll allow me, I'll talk. Try to talk just a little bit, because phase four is starting to bloom. Phase four is starting to bloom. Is wow. We have the tools for it. Full stop in the burn. To put it in a nutshell, full stop in the burn. The tools that have been brought up here on this YouTube channel has been getting us ready for phase four. Getting us ready for phase four. Let me go over the phases again. First phase, and I saw that these phases, I just put them in the context. I would say Jesus' mission of salvation to this world. But I'm putting this in a new context, okay, when I'm using this term, Jesus' mission of salvation to the world. First phase was his life here 2014 years ago starting. And this brought up the recognition that we are missing the mark, sinful. And we last couple thousand years we've been working on accepting that, you know what, I got a problem. I have one problem, but it's a big one. I've been believing that there are forces that God didn't create. Time, space, process, form, for example. Whether they're good forces, bad forces, whatever, I've been believing they're forces that God did not create. And I'm used to this. I'm used to believing that my being is subject to these forces. This is not true. And so, because this is not true, we have to accept the fact that our being, there are no forces affecting our being whatsoever. And the difference between those two is what's called a continuity problem. We say, wait a minute, you want me to accept a life that there's no forces? You know, how can I live? How can I be? I don't know how to function. What are you talking about? That's the continuity fear. Okay, there's one problem, and that's the continuity fear. Huge problem. So we confess that, you know what? I have a severe sin. I have a severe problem. I have a continuity problem. I tried to separate from reality, and in doing so, I wanted to experience my separation by recognizing that now reality was not perfect because I'm now separate from it. So I wanted to experience the imperfection of reality, which doesn't exist, okay? When we do this, when we have a desire to experience the imperfection of reality, what happens is we search for it and we say, oh, it's not here, it must be there. Oh, it's not there, it must be there. Oh, it's not there, it must be there. And you have this endless ricocheting taking place of your search. Your search ricochets endlessly in a completely chaotic manner, becomes utter chaos because it's not anywhere. But your desire to find it just keeps this ricocheting, and it just, you look like a ball of total chaos and confusion. And we react to that. And our reaction to that, an attempt to calm down our reaction, is what we call this universe. This is a conditional existence. Okay, conditional existence. So Jesus came into what we believe, conditional existence, and says, look, there's a mission of salvation here that I'm undertaking. How do we drop this conditioned existence, which is like a way to try to defend against the reaction we had to utter chaos, you see, with a severe continuity problem now. How do we do this? It seems very confusing and difficult, right? So phase one was to get things started. And it says, look, you have a severe problem. You have a continuity problem. You know, forgiveness, forgiveness, forgiveness. It's only a continuity problem. Nothing happened to reality. Nothing has happened to anyone. Everything is still perfect. Spirit, reality is unconditioned oneness. There's no forces or problems or threat at all. Okay. This is all a dream. Conditioned existence is a dream. And we're very confused about it. Let's just leave it at that. Okay. So we've had almost 2,000 years to accept this, like, you know, I really have to, it's really possible, and I really have to repent, which means, says I don't want to be separate from God. Therefore, with that desire, my desire is to not be separate from God. There is no than searching for the imperfection that my, that because there is no attempt to separate, we say, well, I just accept exactly the way it is. And therefore, I'm searching for perfection, you might say. And perfection's everywhere. So there's no ricocheting at all. There's no, with this desire, I desire to not separate from God. There's no ricocheting of the search, of the desire, the search for where's the imperfection. Smooth, peaceful, calm. Okay. So with this desire, this is called repentance, to change your desire, change your mind, change what you desire. We say, I now desire to not try to be separate from God. This is called repentance. With this repentance, then, all that's left is this continuity problem. That's it. Nothing left but this continuity problem. Once one repents and recognizes, yeah, this is the way, I desire to not be separate from God. Therefore, no chaos will arise. No reaction will arise to that. No attempt to manage the reaction will arise to it. You see, none of that. Don't need conditioned existence, actually. But I do have a continuity problem, so I can use conditioned existence for a while. There's a way to use it in order to gradually dissipate the fear, my continuity fear, evaporate it. So this is the start of the mission. And Jesus had a life which was very dramatic and pointed out, wow, is all an appearance. All this is just an appearance. The body is just an appearance. Illness is just an appearance. All of this is merely an appearance. There is no time, space, process, or form whatsoever here. It's just, it is the dance of love, of the living light, but in a way that makes it seem as though it's not, that there are forces. We infer that they're forces, so it's, we're very confused. Okay, he understood. He said, look, you're very confused. That's okay. Got to make a start. Got to make a start. So he had the great clarity, courage, and love to make a start, knowing it's going to take a while. It's going to take a while. So a start was made. Now, so those of us who have been in this world for quite some time have been affected by this start, especially if you've been part of the Western civilization, so to speak. Many of you, if you're on the planet, you're affected by it. Wherever you are, in some ways you're affected by this, actually. A start was made, a very strong start was made. And we're going to just keep it in this context, keep it simple. Now, Jesus knew there's a start, and then there'd have to be a follow-up to it. Phase two was the follow-up. And in 1976, a three-book set was published, A Course in Miracles, which was Jesus transmitting this wisdom and compassion and love to Helen Schuckman, helped with, and William Tetford helped transcribe it and put it into a sort of book form. And that was A Course in Miracles. A Course in Miracles was Jesus saying, okay, now you're ready for phase two. And what was phase two? Phase two was to use words, concepts to clarify. Using words and concepts to clarify. Okay, there's a lot of words in A Course in Miracles. So, this, taking this A Course in Miracles, going through this now, I'm keeping in this context just to keep it simple, but I will clarify some more later. Because we say, what if I haven't studied A Course in Miracles? That's fine. Okay, don't worry. I'm just setting the sort of historical process of these phases here. Now, if you work through words as clarifiers, you reach a certain point where the words start getting in their own way, which is what I experienced. I said, wow, I need some other phase. I'm done with this phase. I'm done with the words as clarifiers phase. What happened next? What happened next was Jesus gave another transmission of this world through Dr. Brent Haskell, PhD DO, transcribing, put it on, he heard some clarification, and he put it down on tapes, then tried and transcribed out the tapes to a book. Journey beyond words. The third phase was journey beyond words. Instead of words as clarifiers, now it's journey beyond words. 1994. Wow. That was awesome to be part of that phase. I just felt like this is just a significantly higher phase. Journey beyond words. The important word is journey there. Journey. In other words, we're moving in that direction beyond words. We're journeying beyond words. Now we've reached phase four. Because in this journeying beyond words, we get close to something. We get glimpses and we say, wow. For example, I have the glimpses of the vision of oneness. And you say, oh my God, that's what I really want. And I've really got to go beyond words. What, you know, but still there's a sense of a journeying, you see. How do I get past that journey? How do I get past that journey? Phase four, suggested to me by the Holy Spirit. And been working towards this for a long time, for 20 years, with Journey Beyond Words. Phase four is being beyond words. Being beyond words. Being beyond words. So just one word change. Instead of journey beyond words, it's being beyond words. Being beyond words. Now, this fourth stage leads to what? The fourth stage leads to the fifth stage. What is the fifth stage? The fifth stage is that which is so sacred that there are no words for it. There simply are no words. And it is this fifth stage that we intuited beginning with stage one. And those who have taken this path, we take it because deep down we realize there is that which is so sacred, there are no words for it. And to even suggest that there are is to damn it with faint praise. That there is something so sacred we leave it untouched by words. Untouched by words. You see. So we are getting closer to that. Being, so we are practicing, phase four is the practicing of being beyond words. It is the practicing of it. Ultimately, stage five is abiding in the vision of oneness, truly abiding in the vision of oneness. Okay. We're not far off from that, actually. Not far off from it. The practicing of being beyond words, brings us to where we feel very comfortable. Our comfort zone is there, where we simply step into that which is so totally, totally sacred. There's no words are even suggested. There are no words for it. There are no words for it. Okay. Now we know that is there, but our problem is how to get there. How to get there. It can be very frustrating. Very frustrating. But we're not without a way here. We're in phase four. If you can just decide, you know what? I'm now with phase four. I'm going with phase four. Just like for me, this life, phase two, I came across A Course in Miracles. I actually saw it in the bookshop. I read through some of it and I said, wow, what is this? This is incredible. And I put it back on the bookshelf and I went home. It is like, I didn't understand what was being said here. I saw the words, but what is he talking about? I couldn't put it together, you know. I thought I could understand anything about words. I just could not understand what was being said, really. So I said, wow, I'm gonna leave that alone. And then I was pestered with dreams, terribly pestered with dreams. Feeling like, what are you doing? You know, what, you know, why you can't handle it? You're lazy? What, you know? I said, wow, fine. I said, okay, I got to go back there. I was so pressured. Went back and bought it and then started. And I right away I realized, oh my God, I this is a new phase. This is a new phase. And wow. It's just like a whole big wow that didn't stop wowing. Okay, it just didn't stop wowing until 15 years later, where I realize now the words are getting in their own way and I just couldn't do it anymore. That's when Journey Beyond Words, and then that was another wow. And that wow's been going for 20 years. So when you get into a new phase, you just realize, oh my God, wow. This is just significantly bigger, closer, significantly closer. Significantly closer to that which is so sacred, there are no words. Significantly closer. And then the wow just continues. The wow just continues. So for those who are ready for it, they're just going to do it. They're just going to do it. And the wow is going to be there. And you just have to just let it be there. And the other phases before that no longer seem so attractive because they just don't generate this wow. They're not as close. Now we're getting really close. Being beyond words. Being beyond words. We're practicing being. Not journeying, but being. Right here, right now. Actually being beyond words. And we're practicing this, which is very cool. And yet this phase will seem quite different than the phases that came before. So it's sort of like there's this transitional period that we're in right now. And I'm working on this transition. And it's quite different than the phases that came before. Because this closeness to that which there are no words for, getting so close to it, you know, we really have to get used to that. And you can't do it the way we used to do it. It doesn't work. So I think there are some that feel stuck right now, that feel stuck. And they say, I feel stuck. I just can't seem. That's what happened to me with A Course in Miracles. I reached a point where I just felt like no matter how much I studied and read and tried to, I just felt I was stuck. I said, I can't go any further. Cannot go any further. Okay, fine. Time to get unstuck. How do you do it? Not by spinning the wheels within the phase that you've already been in. Is shifting to the next phase. Phase four. Shift to phase four. That's when the shift hits the fan, so to speak. Right? That's when the shift hits the fan. And what happens? Wow's everywhere. Like, wow. Wow. It's amazing. I mean, when I read Journey Beyond Words, I was just blown away. I was 15 years with A Course in Miracles, and I thought I was really, really got it, you know. Then I read Journey Beyond Words, and it just was wow. Jesus just blew me away with that one, just brought the hammer down. He just... I said, wow, are you kidding me? This is fantastic. This is amazing. This is even better. Holy cow. What a clarification. My God. So, you're supposed to be blown away. You're supposed to... The shift hits the fan, and there's wow everywhere. And you just walk around and say, holy cow, this is just great. This is just great. That's why I'm enthused. This is just great. Great thing is we're practicing being beyond words. We're not trying to leap from the third phase to the fifth phase. We have a fourth phase here, which is great, because the leap, I kept trying, wow, I got a glimpse of it. Yeah, I got a glimpse of it. It was in March of 2014. I realized the vision of oneness is right there. In fact, it's right here, right now. It's right here, right now. All we have to do is be with it. Yeah, well, all we have to do is be with it, but then you keep going back to words and concepts. Now, what is a concept? A concept is here and there. Here and there. It's not here, it's there. It's not here, it's there. If it's not there, it's here. It's here and there. Which is what? The search for imperfection, you see. Concepts arose out of our search for imperfection with imperfection. Because it's not here, it must be there. Oh, it's not there, it must be there. Concepts, here and there. Duality, here and there. Here and there. Now, what is the tool that is, I would say, most useful full stop in the burn, going beyond, being beyond words, being beyond words. It's no longer a journey beyond words, being beyond words. It is required to have this full stop in the burn, where we're not using words to clarify what we just heard. We heard something and then we do a full stop in it. We're not adding words, we're not subtracting words. We're not adding time, we're not subtracting time. We're not adding space, we're not subtracting space. We're not doing anything. We're just right here, right now. And this is the way to reverse out of the momentum of this delusional dream. The supposed momentum of imaginary forces that are supposedly shaping our soul and to save our soul through being shaped by these imagine. That's momentum. We have to reverse out of that momentum. So the way to reverse out of that momentum is just full stop in this burn, is the consternation. Full stop in this consternation. Like, wow, you know, wait a minute. What do I need to do? No, full stop. And just let it boil. Let the consternation boil. What this does is transforms anger. It transforms all frustration, all anger, all of that, by consciously, willfully applying this full stop. You realize you're in control of words, of concepts, of imaginary forces, of all this. You now are assuming control of this, which is getting very close to being beyond words, right? Very close. Practicing it. Full stop. Another way, full stop in the now. But we say full stop in the burn. Because if you say full stop in the now, this consternation is still there. You say, wait a minute, the now is supposed to be happy. No. Full stop in the burn, because the consternation of a momentum is there. And just let the momentum boil without doing anything about it. So everything that is conveyed in this phase right now, in this phase four, it's heard and listened to with this full stop in the burn. Whatever consternation arises, you don't do anything about it. You just smile, say, great, lots of consternation arising, wonderful. Not doing anything about it, not adding words, not subtracting words, not adding duration, not subtracting duration. Not adding location, not subtracting location. Not adding any process, subtracting process. Not adding any form to it, not subtracting any form to it. You see? Full stop in the burn. Full stop in the burn. Full stop in the burn. So, this is the quick technique, the instant technique, full stop on the burn. It's instantaneous. You center yourself instantly in phase four by full stop on the burn. Full stop on the burn. And then once you've done that, you can say the continuity practice, I do not have a consternation problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The consternation problem doesn't exist. It has, therefore, has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This is practicing being beyond words. This is practicing being beyond words. So these are two of the techniques that we can use, that can be used. Now, so, you know, some like some structure, some like to freelance. Either way is fine. If it works, it works. Whatever works. Or sometimes a combination of some freelancing and some structure. Whatever works. Some will use their, you know, come up with their own practices, their own ways, through the Holy Spirit and the intuition, they will develop, you know, their own freelancing way. That is fine. If that works, it's fine. Others will say, you know what, a little structure isn't so bad right now. You know, it can help. It can actually help. So that's also fine. Certainly, there has to be effectiveness. So for me, I become, I recognize that I become a pragmatist instead of an idealist. So a pragmatist will say, okay, this is where you know effectiveness can be found. It's gonna and gonna say, okay, that's where I'm at, is getting it done actually, instead of leaping. Idealism tends to say, well, how do I leap from this phase over the next phase all the way? How do I leap into that which is totally sacred, and therefore there are no words? How do I leap into that? That's called spiritual idealism. And a lot of us have been through that phase of spiritual idealism. And we get very frustrated because it doesn't work. Nobody's going to leap like that. Not really. We think we should be able to, but the continuity fear holds us back. So then we become pragmatists. Gradually we become more and more pragmatic, which is what has happened to me. I used to be very spiritual idealistic, and over the years of failure, I've become more and more pragmatic. And say, hey, you know what? Practice is very helpful. Very helpful. Now, the practice in phase four is very different than the practice in phase three. Now the question is, can we be all things to everybody? Can we help with phase one? Can we help with phase two? Can we help with phase three? Well, someone has to help with phase four. And I don't want to spread myself too thin. You know, that's a problem. So I feel like, at this point, focusing on phase four. Now, there are those who are still working with phase three, that's fine. But that phase three is can be very much a self-taught sort of phase. Two and three can be freelancing. I freelanced phase two and phase three. It's something that you can self-taught. You can do it yourself, so to speak. Phase one, you need some supportive institutional system just to get you to that point of realizing, you know what, I need to make this start. Once we get started, then we can start getting to phase two. And we have the capacity to do that. But now, phase four, it could be helpful to render some assistance at this phase four, because phase four it's possible to speak out like this because of seeing the vision of oneness, knowing the vision of oneness is there, and having very much certainty about it. That enables them to get into phase four with courage and conviction, certitude, and that. But if there haven't been any glimpses of this totality, this complete, perfect, all-inclusive oneness, if there haven't been any holy instance, any glimpses at all, then I would say you cannot get into phase four. It's too difficult. However, if you have had in some way, even for an instant, a glimpse, just a glimpse, it lasts just an instant, and you just say, oh wow, I know that's there, yeah. If you've really had that, and you know you've had it, then I would say, it's possible to do phase four. However, the problem is you tend to think, well, is that really true? I mean, is it really possible? And it just seems like, really? I can do it? You know, really? Is it doable? Yeah, it is. So it's some stage four is where we encourage one another in phase four. those who are into phase four encourage one another and say, yeah, this is doable. Absolutely. Practicing being beyond words is something we can do. We can do that. We can do it. So it's collective. It's collective. Those who are in stage four encourage one another. It's collective that way. For those who offer up encouragement, you know, that's just part of the collective endeavor. Some might seem to be more comfortable in it than others. You know, that's just the way it is. Everybody's got slightly different continuity fear at work, at play. Okay. So I just happen to be able to do this, what I'm doing here. Just the way that my past history and my life and everything that I've done, it just, I'm able, I feel a comfort zone doing this. See, doing this. Others have a comfort zone doing something else, sharing in some other way. So, whatever way you have to share in phase four, that's, do it. Now, here's something important to consider. Just because someone is sharing and helping out in some way like this, that doesn't mean, you know, that they're necessarily, you know, far along. Doesn't necessarily mean that. I could just be throwing batting practice, you know, like throwing batting practice to Barry Bonds, you know, or something. Here, hit this one on the fence. Hit this one on the fence. You know, just like that. And you know, where you just hitting everyone, you know, a mile. You know, as I'm just throwing batting practice. Okay, but the one who's throwing batting practice also doesn't mean that they can't hit it a mile. Also, doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that. All that's important is that we practice. That we get it done. That's all that counts. That's all that counts. So I feel like I'm just barely able, you know, to keep up. Just barely able to keep up. Barely able to keep up. But somehow struggling along and keeping up. Somehow segueing into phase four here. But that's good enough. You know, it's good enough. So good enough is good enough. And from my experience, I would say there are very few superstars in the world, if any, actually. Right? It seems like everybody it has this, you know, tremendous, well, the continuity fear has pummeled all of us, right? Made fools of us all, have pummeled our health, have delayed us, have put us in bad situations. It just seems like nobody is just la-di-da in the, you know, phase four. Oh, there's a breeze, just breeze in, no trouble. It doesn't seem to work that way, does it? And so I would say, you know, being, it's like we've been on a baton death march. And we're just like, wow, where have we survived this far? How do we survive? Okay. But just doing it is succeeding. Just doing it is succeeding. So even if you barely can get into it and just, wow, I just barely made it. That's good enough. That's good enough. You don't have to be some superstar. You know, not many of those around, actually. I mean, certainly can't afford for them to show up. You know, don't hold your breath waiting for them. Forget it. You know, they may not show up. I don't know. Just have to do it anyway. Just do it anyway. Now, in the practicing of phase four, the basic practice, at least at this point, and we will see how it goes, from my standpoint, is this full stop in the burn. So I may be throwing batting practice, and you may be getting this consternation, and then just practicing full stop in the burn. And by the way, I was very good at throwing batting practice when I was younger. I could throw batting practice all day. So that's another thing. I seem to just be able, you know, just throwing and just, and I was able to, you know, place it just right so that they could hit it, you know, really beautifully. But I could also hit really well too. But I liked to throw batting practice, really did. Very much enjoyed it. So what I'm doing is I'm putting this out there like batting practice for you. And say, so you just wail on it, you know, just wail on it. And it's supposed to dredge up this consternation. It's supposed to dredge up the consternation around concepts, words, continuity fear. And you're supposed to then just allow this consternation, just wow, feel it, and say, this is great, full stop, and just full stop in the burn here. It's like an intense, but you take intense batting practice and you say, wow. And then you take a break. You take a break and you just sit on the bench and just like, you don't think at all. You just feel. I mean, you just feel how it felt to hit the ball so perfect and the crack of a bat and the hitting on a sweet spot and just the swing and just everything. Just sit there and just let that feeling just reverberate. Just let it reverberate. So you build up the intensity, let the intensity rise, and then you just abide in it. Because words are just getting shredded. Words are just... See, we're so insistent on putting words together. Right? I mean, we're so insistent on concepts, on thoughts. What we need to do is to start to experience these words, these concepts, these thoughts becoming so fluid that specificity and definition seem to be turning liquid, turning fluid. And we say, wait a minute. Where are my definitions going? Where are my words, what are words' definitions? Not here, there, you know, basically, not here, there, not there, here, no, no, not here, no, there, no, there, there, no, here, here, not here, no, there, ah. Words make us feel safe, you know, safe from chaos, seemingly. So, as these words break down, as everything seems to get more and more fluid, that gives rise to this just, like, freak out, almost, you know, freak out. Yeah, freak out like that, but it's a very gentle, controlled freak out. You're consciously saying, freaking out this way, and feeling the consternation. And then full stopping it, not doing anything at all about it. Just being with it, just be with it. Because this consternation you're feeling really is fear. And the fear is the fear of being beyond words. That is the fear we have. Because we feel that we're not protected from chaos, you see. We're not protected from chaos. Words seem to organize, be organizing, right? Here and there, not here, over there. Subject-object. We're going beyond the subject-object wordiness, conceptualness, dualityness. So we're just being without definition, without specificity, without form, without format, without structure. And so this feeling of jitteriness. And so you just abide with that jitteriness in a positive frame of mind, like, wow, this burn is great. now, you may be shaking, you may be trembling, you may just feel like you're coming unglued, and you just say, oh, that's fine, that's great. Full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. So your will, you're establishing a comfort zone now in phase four. You're establishing a comfort zone. You're practicing being beyond words. Being beyond words. Or you could say, being without words. This is another way. Being without words. Maybe that's even better. Even better way to say it. Being without words. Being without definition. It's an ordeal. When you take a phase, it's an ordeal. It's an ordeal. Except for the fifth phase. And who knows? Maybe that is an ordeal also in some way. I don't know. But these phases are ordeals. So you're not necessarily going to get all happy right away. You're going to feel the strain. You're going to feel the strain. It's an ordeal. But you know, a spiritual athlete welcomes the ordeal. You have to be a spiritual athlete. Of course, a lot of people in the world, they're working on being physical athletes. Those are the unrepentant pagans, a lot of them. Look, we're going through this ordeal of getting real. We're physical athletes. Look how, you know, tone, we can do these triathlons and everything. We're awesome. This though, is for spiritual athletes, where they put themselves through this workout, through this ordeal. It just challenges the spiritual will, the willingness, challenges the willingness to keep on going. Being without words, maybe being without words. So I'm experiencing an intense burn with this. Where you can the inner fear is evident, like jittery, like wow. Being without words, no advice, you know, nothing there, being without words. Now, so I would say, what I may try to do is throw batting practice for you. Just throw batting practice. Now, of course, I'm getting this benefit too by coming up with the batting practice, and I'm experiencing the burn too, for sure. I need to stop, take a breather too sometimes, for sure. I'm no spiritual superstar. I'm just struggling like everyone else. Just using my whatever talents I have left, talents, and just using them, which is what we need to do. So it's really quite simple. It's to simply practice this abiding without words, abiding in this burn, full stop in the burn. It's a workout. That's a funny thing. We're going beyond fear. We're going beyond the doom of the world, of course. And yet this feels like even worse, doesn't it? It seems like some kind of uber doom. without words, it's uber doom. Like, oh my gosh. And the tendency is to run back to the doom and gloom that this world is like, you know, super saturated with. Look at the news, go back to the news. So I would say there have to be some good habits and just certain things you say I'm not going to do. I'm going to try to stay away from that. I decided if I'm going to do this, since I'm going to do this, stay away from the news. Stay away from the news. Stay away from the negativity. Stay away from the doom. Stay away from all that stuff. Because that's an easy way out. I'm very comfortable with that. I say, oh, okay, here's the fear. I'm going to project my fear on the world here and feel it there, instead of realizing it's really coming from the fear of going without concepts, thoughts, words. That's our real fear. And it's a fear of chaos, even though we know the chaos is not there. And it's a continuity fear. It's a continuity fear because, oh my gosh, I don't know what perfection's like. I've forgotten what perfection's like. And I need words to make it seem like it's not perfect. I need concepts to make it seem like it's not perfect. See, I need belief in forces so I don't believe, so I can stay away from perfection. That's how we turn our back on perfection, is through thinking, concepts, words, belief in forces. So here we're practicing being without words, without concepts, without thoughts, without belief in forces. And we're not getting to the negative. We're also not getting to the positive. We're not getting the positive. We're not trying to show you pictures of flowers or something, right? No. Because the positive tends to make us think of positive words, positive thoughts, positive concepts, positive forces, all of which are totally delusional because they believe they're protecting against negative thoughts, negative words, concepts, and forces, which reinforces the belief that there are forces. There are no forces. So, you know, there are no forces. No time, space, process, or form whatsoever, actually. So, we're not using all sorts of positive stuff, nor the doom and gloom. Neither one. We're practicing just abiding without words, without images, without concepts, without thoughts, words, no here, no there. Of course, which is perfection, which is reality. There's no imperfection there. So there's no here or there. In terms of not here, but there. Or not there, but here. There is none of that. It's all just one. Of course, in this phase, it's not a question and answer format anymore. A dialogue, it's not a dialogue format or question and answer format. It's batting practice now. It's time for batting practice because the game is about to start. So you just have to get into the swing of it, so you're ready for phase five. Preparing for phase five. Because if we're still insisting that whatever we experience has to lend itself to words, how can we get into phase five? We cannot. We cannot. It'll be forever just be a memory, an experience, and to think about, to conceptualize about, to talk about, talking shop and all that. No, talking shop is over. It has to be over. And so. So all we're doing is we're merely practicing. We're just experiencing this full stop in the burn. Full stop in the burn. Just in doing this, we're able to then get even more, without words, more intensity without words, more intensity without words. The burn will still be there. It's uncomfortable. It's like, wow, it's an ordeal. But this is how it gets the job done, in my opinion. This is how I see, this is how the job gets done pragmatically. Pragmatically. I'm just experiencing an intense root burn, as it were. Just wow. You see, because you're not going towards either positive or negative, not positivity or negativity, not positive words, not negative words, not positive images, not negative images. So you might call it intentional, conscious suffering. But it's not really experienced as suffering because you do it intentionally, consciously. You intuit it like this is very helpful. So it's like a workout. It's like a workout. I mean, some people, if people don't want to work out, like they want to take a hike, and their muscles start hurting and stuff, and they say, oh, I'm in such pain. This is horrible. You're torturing me. This is suffering. Ah. Whereas if you really want to do this, and you say, I want to get to the top of this mountain. This is great. You feel the same aches and pains, but you say, that's no problem. That's great. That means I'm getting there. So you see, it's half empty or half full. So to get into phase four, we have to say, it's neither half empty nor half full. That's what we have to say. And not spare ourselves some convenient conceptualization. Here it's not either half empty. It's neither half empty nor half full. Now, I've been practicing some of the phase four practices. And in doing that, it throws you, you know, throws you into consternation. Like, wow, I expected, we expect certain process of words. We expect words to be put into, have so-called relative meaning process. And when it doesn't happen, we're like waiting for it to happen. Like, come on, you know, finish it, finish it, finish it, finish it. And when it doesn't happen, we're just like, ah, I feel this ache, like, come on. That's the burn, full stop in that burn. And in the videos I've been sharing here, sometimes I'll be talking about something and it'll stop. And just let it go. Talking about something else, just stop, let it go. Don't finish your thoughts. So this has been sort of preparatory. It's been preparatory. But again, now this is a shift. Okay, it's a shift. So I want, what I'm conveying here, want to convey, is this next phase is a shift. It's a wow shift. It's a wow shift. And you're going to just be like, wow. Holy cow. And you can dwell in wow land if you want. You know, you can dwell in this wow, which is what these phases are all about. And looking back, you say, thank God I took that phase. You know, I look back and what I've done, said, wow, that is tremendous. Thank God I took those phases, took the trouble, went through the suffering, the misery, took the trouble. It was worth it. You know, it was worth it to put the effort forward. If I had not done it, oh man, I really regret it, really regret it. So this phase four, always practice. It's so important. I've said that quiet sitting is so important for a length of time. This discipline enables one to get into the next phase, phase four, where no matter what the turmoil, consternation is, you have this poise and confidence, and you just say, it's okay. I can just sit here quietly. I don't have to act anything out. Nothing's bad going to happen. Nothing's going to happen. Those who are ready for phase four, if they've not been listening to the videos previously, it may seem like they have to bootstrap themselves. But if you're ready, you're ready. And so you just have to use your will and say, I can do this. I can sit quietly. I can commit to not acting upon anything. No matter what arises, positive or negative, I'm not going to act on anything. I'm not going to think, put words, do anything about it. I'm just going to sit here quietly. Well, now I'm going to stop this one here and see what is suggested next. All right, so this is just, again, another video getting us up to speed, getting us up to speed. It's a shift. It's a wow shift. It is a wow shift. And you use your discipline and your will to make the shift. And your clarity. Okay, very great, that's it.